Yeah, so good evening. Welcome to SCI-Arc. I am David Ruy. I am chair of postgraduate programs here. Is Liam Young an architect? I think so. Though Liam may choose to disagree, Liam Young is the head of the fiction and entertainment program here at SCI-Arc. He started this groundbreaking program 5 years ago. The program is, I think, hitting its stride now, and its graduates are doing some outstanding things out there in that so-called world. Some of them have achieved a pretty impressive level of notoriety, in fact, also, doing things you normally wouldn't expect architects to do. Is SCI-Arc a school of architecture? I think so. But what do we mean by this word architecture anyway? It's to be debated. SCI-Arc is known for this debate. I, for one, am proud to be part of this debate at this great institution. Liam Young is a storyteller. Liam constructs fictions, don't we all? We are hungry for the real, like maybe never before, but we construct the real with stories. Stories about who we are, who we have been, who we would like to be. We tell stories about faraway places and places just down the street, about things that happened long ago and things that won't happen for a long time to come. We tell our stories using old strategies and new ones, using old media and new media. We comment on it. We troll it. We post and repost it. We send our likes, then succumb to our greatest weakness, but also our greatest strength, forgetfulness. We're impatient. We think we've heard all the fucking stories before. But at the same time, we can't get enough. We have been telling each other stories since the beginning, but in our time, it has also become deeply imbricated with our technologies of communication. We live in a din of storytelling. There are stories everywhere. It comes at us from every direction. It's really hard to tell what's even real anymore. Architecture contributes to this cacophony. As it has done for a long time, architecture remains a powerful platform for storytelling. Architecture is everywhere. It's hard to find wilderness these days. When we think we're looking at the real, we're usually, in fact, looking at architecture. Liam Young is a speculative architect who operates in the spaces between design, fiction, and futures. He is co-founder of Tomorrow's Thoughts Today, an urban futures think tank exploring the local and global implications of new technologies and unknown fields, and nomadic research studio that travels on expeditions to chronicle these emerging conditions as they occur in the ground. He is a BAFTA nominated producer and has premiered with platforms ranging from Apple Plus, Channel 4, TED, SXSW, that is South by Southwest, Tribeca, the New York Metropolitan Museum, the Royal Academy, Venice Biennale, and The Guardian. This list could be longer. There's a lot of eyes on Liam, including mine. The format for tonight's event is a bit different from normal. We will begin with a live cinema performance by Liam entitled Planet City and the Return of the Global Wilderness. By the way, the book that has been published in conjunction with this project is available here at the event. You probably saw the table with Hennessy Ingalls. After this performance, it will be followed by a discussion between Liam and Stanley Chen, an author of science fictions. Nice to meet you tonight. The discussion will be moderated by Aaron Curtis, who is a curator at the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art. So please stay for that as well. Finally, we would like to thank, a heartfelt thanks to the Getty Foundation for supporting SCI-Arc's Views of Planet City project as part of its Pacific Standard Time initiative. The project is being led by Liam in collaboration with several other SCI-Arc faculty, John Cooper, Angelica Lorenzi, Damian Jovanovic, Casey Rehm, and Jennifer Chen. Thank you generously for making time to be with us tonight. Please welcome Liam Young.
Thanks, David. Thanks, everyone, for coming out. To all the corridor dwellers over there, and maybe you're there because that's where the bar is, but there's acreage of concrete floor over here, like for the full immersive 180 experience. You've got 2 minutes of my preamble to squeeze through the chairs and come up here, or you can limbo under the screen on the left and squeeze in the front too. I'm only going to do a little ditty for about 35 minutes before we shift into the conversation, but neither do you want to be standing in the corridor for that time. I'm going to put stuff on the screen, so you might want to be able to see it. Cool, thanks. Okay. So I also thanks for the turnout. I'm aware that there's probably a lot of people from outside of the SCI-Arc community here tonight. Welcome. What you have missed across the last couple of days, you join us at a rather interesting moment. We've seen an amazing kind of collective action from the student body asking the institution, really, and the school to be accountable for a lot of the labor practices and a lot of the dark sides of the discipline rearing its head within the school. We saw it in film several months ago with a lot of the collective union action. It's a really inspiring time. We're against the backdrop of systemic failures by traditional institutions and instruments that were supposedly acting in our best interests. We're witnessing a generation of people unwilling to accept the broken worlds that they're inheriting. Tonight, we're going to be telling stories about the future. And across the last few days, it's been thrilling to witness people passionately making demands for their own future. And thank you to all those students who have and continue to give their voice. And it's just the beginning of the conversation, I'm sure. And related, I guess, you know, as David mentioned, I do come from a background in architecture, but I've been at Escape Velocity for some time now. And really what I do is, at the moment, is tell stories with and about space. I'm more so, as David mentioned, a speculative architect, meaning I don't design traditional buildings, but instead I make films and build imaginary worlds for the entertainment industry and tell stories about the architectural, urban, or global implications of new technologies. So whether it be through my own projects, like the one Planet City that we're discussing tonight, or world building for film and TV here in LA, we use imagined fictional worlds as a site in which to explore important ideas, not just to sell tickets or to create a backdrop for that superhero caped crusader moment, but we really believe that fiction is this extraordinary shared language. It's how our culture communicates and disseminates ideas. And we're all literate in stories, and they're accessible and public in sometimes a way that an architectural drawing or diagram is not. Narratives of these imagined worlds can help us to visualize other possible futures. futures that often sit outside of the one that in day to day feels all too inescapable. So these stories are both products of culture. What's important is they also produce culture. And I think that is the moment in which we're in. So we're going to dive in. I try and frame my talks not as slideshows or PowerPoint presentations, but rather as illustrated narratives, story-selling safaris woven from documentaries that we've made and the science fiction worlds that we've constructed. So with the exception of a few clips from Blade Runner, all of the scenes, both imaginary and real, are drawn from a collective body of all of our film projects. Specifically tonight, we're going to go on this cinematic drift through a screenscape of imagined worlds, because I want to tell a story about two cities that fit the entire population of the Earth, one that is entirely fictional, and one that we are currently all already occupying. So let's fire up the autonomous electric AI megadrone hyperdrives and get moving. See you all on the other side, where we'll be talking with Stanley and Aaron at the end of the journey. Let's roll. In many ways, all cities are fictions. Their literal edges are nebulous, and their physical definition is endlessly being rewritten, but their boundaries will come into focus as shared narratives. The fiction of a city can weigh as much as its physical shadow. They are lived and occupied, they are read and watched with consequence and meaning. I'm both a director and an architect. I tell stories about cities, some real and some imagined. Because the urban imaginary has always been a site in which we might prototype new scenarios and emerging cultures. In their speculative streets, we play out the multiple unexpected or unintended futures that they might set in motion and their associated social and political ideologies. So whether it be speculation around the impacts of industrialization or mass production, the imminent arrival of driverless cars and seamless augmented reality, or artificial intelligence, these fictional worlds give form to our most wondrous technological possibilities and our gravest concerns. The Ecumenopolis is no longer a fiction. The Ecumenopolis is a word that we give to a planet-wide city that's long been a narrative of science fiction cities. The term was conceived in 1967 by a Greek city planner to describe this hypothetical narrative context of total planetary urbanization. And across the history of imaginary cities, amongst many others, the worldwide city has taken on the form of the sprawl in William Gibson's trilogy, or a world without trees in Silent Running and Trantor. And here we see a planet entirely of architecture in Asimov's Foundation trilogy. But of course, today, the Ecumenopolis is here, and we already are citizens of this planetary city. And following centuries of colonization and globalization, and never-ending economic extraction, we have remade the world from the scale of the cell to the tectonic plate. And our urban development has forever changed the atmosphere, the oceans, and the earth. In many ways, there is no city or country anymore. There is no nature and technology. But instead, we have now engineered a continuous urban construct that stretches across the entirety of the earth. It's an unevenly distributed megastructure that hides in plain sight. And it wasn't master planned by some single imperial power or a cyberpunk megacorporation, but it was slowly stitched together from stolen lands by planetary logistics, where landscapes have become resource fields, countries have become factory floors, the countryside has become industrialized agriculture, and the oceans have become conveyor belts. And the dystopias of science fiction that previously read as speculative cautionary tales are now the stage sets of the everyday, as we live out our lives in a disaster film that's playing in real time. And any aspirational or distant future has given way to this critical re-narration of the dystopian present, and the future is broken, and we're left stranding in the long now, staring at empty calendars, doom-scrolling idly, waiting out the end of the world. But perhaps it's this moment without a future, as a slow-motion catastrophe envelops us at a speed that makes it relatively comfortable to ignore, I want to tell a story about another planet city. A counter-narrative. A concentrated city for the entire population of the Earth, the anti-city to the sprawl that we all inhabit. Tonight's journey is going to be a story of two cities. Two cities the size of the planet. A city symphony, a portrait of a place stitched together from fragments of science fiction films and narrative documentaries we've made with our documentary studio Unknown Fields. Slipping between fiction and documentary, it will be a sci-fi safari, one that is already here, and another city that will never exist. Of the world in 2050. If we listen, we can hear the hums and crackles of the flickering LEDs that illuminate the lower reaches of the city's farm fields. It smells of soil and hard drives and sweet fruit. A purple sunrise over a new kind of wild. Seminal biologist Edward O. Wilson imagined a new world he called Half-Earth, a place planned to stave off mass extinction by devoting half the surface of the Earth completely to nature. For Wilson, the magnitude of the problems that face us are far too large to be tackled with small gestures, and any solution must respond with this scale and urgency. But of course, the byproduct of Wilson's global park is also the massive consolidation of our existing cities and lifestyles that would be required to withdraw from the remaining 50% of the Earth. Would we be willing to make such an extraordinary change? What would our lives in this new world order look like? So this is the speculation of where Planet City begins. What if we were to design and visualize this radical reversal of our planetary sprawl? Such extraordinary crises require the most radical and bold responses. How far could we push Wilson's proposal to save the Earth? In its most provocative form, if we were to reorganize our world at the intensity of the densest cities that currently exist, then Planet City could actually occupy as little as 0.02% Earth. Could we imagine coming to this global consensus? We listen to a story of a young climate activist, one of the city's first citizens.
She arrived first. Her yacht dropped anchor. The first foundation of what would soon be our new world. It was just an idea. A hashtag, a post, a status update drifting across the network, waiting for people to listen. A deafening roar sometimes begins with just the softest whisper.
But of course, beyond this beginning fiction, today's planetary city that we all currently occupy is already an extraordinary constellation of products, goods, and technologies. From the smallest and most inconsequential of objects to the most intricate and complex, the materials, things set in motion a vast planetary scale infrastructure. And of course, in a world of bytes and bitcoins, cyberplace, cyberspace and clouds, 90% of the world's cargo still travels to us by sea. It's not beamed or teleported or conjured into existence along strings of fiber optics, but rather it is dragged across the ocean in heaving steel megaships. Gizzards fill with glistening gadgets and gizmos, refined geologies wrenched from the earth and scattered to the sea. The global shipping fleet connects the massive mining excavations scattered on the edge of the world to the sites where we live. These are the sites where our planetary city begins and ends its life. But in our imaginary planet city, we can imagine the world shipping fleet that used to scatter this matter ripped from the earth across our malls and storefronts of global streets could be reversed, to bring all that material back together again as seams of planetary culture and architecture performed in the geological strata of the city.
People packed up their homes, their precious possessions, the raw fabric of their lives. They mined our old cities rather than virgin ground. They were recombining our resources in a new constellation that would be more efficient, more compact, more home.
And so, one by one, we might arrive through a global citizen consensus, a voluntary and multi-generational retreat from the world we once knew. But today, out in the distance, on the uneven edges of our existing planetary city, is the lithium triangle. The electric earth will soon power our world. So if we were to stage such a retreat, if we were to reimagine the world, it would mean reimagining landscapes like this one. This tessellated ocean of evaporation ponds cuts through a region of Chile and Bolivia and Argentina, and contains almost all of the world's lithium resources, the key ingredient in all the batteries that power our technologies. Our collective dreams of a renewable planet, the prophecies and profiteering of tech evangelist Elon Musk, are all buried here beneath the salt flats of Bolivia. And the indigenous population that belonged to this land tell of a creation story of lithium. They tell of the tears and breast milk of a mythic volcano that have mixed together to crystallize into the lithium lake. And this massive mining landscape, carved out of one of the most rarest and most precious ecosystems on the planet, is the geology enacted when you power on your laptop or slide your slimline phone into your pocket. And it sits well beyond the horizon of towering buildings and dense streets and cities where most of the current population lives. But at the same time, it's a product of the city, and in turn produces the city. It's a landscape hidden in the stretching shadows, disguised, ignored, or forgotten. Invisible in the ad for the latest Apple I whatever, or the hype of the Hyperloop. We power our city with the breast milk of volcanoes. And as we travel to our imaginary planet city, we see that the bright white of the lithium salt flats fades into pink, the beta carotene of the city's algae canals. So these are the batteries of planet city, alive with fish and algae. As excess wind and solar power pumps water through the canals to high-altitude holding lakes in the city's upper floors, lithium batteries are replaced by the potential energy of elevated water bodies that snake their way through the towers. Before dawn breaks, thousands of autonomous cleaning blades squeak along the solar fields, and waves of mirrors ripple as they rotate to chase the changing light. A billion panels collected from all over the world, charging the city's canals. So when needed, the dams open and the turbines turn. Tides rise and fall as lights glow and televisions blare and hard drives spin. And the lights of the city's farms flicker on. In Planet City, we're not precious about where we get our light. Our synthetic suns cast purple shadows, yet still warms the skin and helps fertilize the soil. The blue and red spectrum of light is the most efficient for growth, and the stacked farms funnel in the city's carbon. The landscapes are a sequestration and scrubbing machine, the byproduct of which is food. But beyond the Planet City walls, in our other existing city, deep in the snowy Siberian Ural Mountains, the cucumbers of the double-glazed indoor farms know no seasonal boundaries. Today, 600-watt sodium bulbs run across the ceiling in measured rows of artificial suns. And workers dressed in white gowns and plastic booties, more at home in a clean room laboratory than a productive field, watch on through the glass. They occupy narrow corridors that run in between the human exclusion zones where the crops are grown, restricted to work in specific rooms so as not to spread microorganisms to others. The simulated sky turns off at 8 a.m. and back on at 2 p.m. as an automated accelerated day is programmed to induce faster growth. A group of neighbors overlooking the farm save on electricity bills. They leave their lights on in the evening and open their curtains to the cucumbers illuminated below. Today's cities turn day into night and night into day, populating our stores with goods across a singular planetary season. But here we see in our new planet city, in the fiction we chase the seasons through the height of the city. Vertical orchards weave through the tower's 160 floors. and between them birds migrate through the climate zones. But we jump back to our existing city, and we see another landscape, a cotton field, and we see a young Indian textile worker who's walking slowly on a planetary procession. The water of the city pours in. These are the landscapes that produce the $3 t-shirt, an icon of the modern city. Fast fashion's rolling tide dumps mountains of cheap clothing onto our shores. Objects of desire, worn for one wild night and destined to be discarded. If we were to pick at a loose thread and unravel it from the planetary city, across wardrobes and warehouses, from factory to field, in search of the landscapes behind our runway dreams and street blue jeans, this is where we would end. Because before we wear them, our clothes make journeys of tens of thousands of miles in their process of production. And of course, the byproduct of this pace and scale of clothing industry is the destruction of the very thing that brought it to Southeast Asia originally. Here we meet the last generation of master weavers, a group whose skills will now die when they die. The apprentices they would once train now man the rumbling, mechanized looms of global fashion, raw cotton plugging their ears, deaf to the din of the world around them. And here we visit the last real gold thread maker, an alchemist who lovingly tweaks the machine his grandfather made, resisting the move to synthetic, cheap and fake yarns used by all the other companies around him. And she slowly walks through the rows of plants on a sacred procession from her home village amongst the cotton fields, through the huge mills and factories of the vast textile industry supply chain where she works. And she walks across this planetary city, and she's gradually wrapped in a glistening gold textile as she bears witness to a series of transformations like weaving, dyeing, sewing, and pressing. And her journey suggests the walk along the fashion catwalk, or the path that our disposable fashion might take in its global production, or the path so many women like her have taken in moving from village to factory to city. And her journey ends as she's completely cocooned, standing at the huge container port amongst the mega container ships that will soon export her and everything she wears to the center of our present planetary city. And as we move through our fictional city, the costumes we encounter are crafted from zero waste patterns, and they're woven on computer-controlled looms. In Planet City, there are no offcuts. No material is lost. All the fibers are reformed from old fabrics, pulped up and compressed into felts and stitched together. No new resources are expended to dress the citizens of this new city. And we watch as they join a different kind of continuous procession, an endless festival that dances its way through the city on a 365-day loop. And each day it intersects with another carnival or culture or celebration. It changes the beat as it goes, cycling through new colors and costumes and cacophonies. And the ghosts of nation-states give way to communities formed around shared cultural practices, as we perform new kinds of myths of care and belonging and recreation. In today's cities, bodies dance with a different kind of precision. The majority of the world's gemstones are pulled out of the ground by the human conveyor belts of Madagascar's gem fields. This is a strange music video portrait of these digging machines that excavate the majority of the world's precious sapphires. In these illegal mines, it's cheaper to pay 20 men in rice than it is to maintain and fuel a mechanical conveyor belt. A hidden black market supply chain connects two choreographies, one in these lawless mine sites, and the other in the jewelry stores, music videos, and celebrity red carpets across the cities that we're all familiar with. And here their movements are traced like the early photographic studies of Frank Gilbraith, who was mapping the choreographies of the production line, looking to optimize every movement, constrain every motion with the elegance of a tuned engine. The digger is a robot, just another component in the gemstone conveyor belt. 2,880 shovels per day, moving 5.67 tons of soil. We dig holes to try and find the river again, one of the miners tells us. The technologies that were once designed to optimize the global production line are now operating at urban scales. Today, we're endlessly scanned by countless sensors, lasers, cameras, and satellites that all feed the city operating systems. This, for example, is how autonomous vehicles scan the city, and they render them as these 3D point clouds. In this film, across a single night, a group of teenagers drift through the imaginary planet city in a driverless taxi. They're part of an underground rave community, and they dance with explosive contortions as they invent a new choreography that distorts the silhouette of the body and disguises the proportions of their frame so as to evade body detection algorithms that are used by the city surveillance cameras. It's a new vocabulary of movement that is exuberant in plain sight, but through the eyes of the machine, two bodies become one. Entangled with fractured limbs, fuzzy frames, and lost connections. We're always searching for the wilds beyond the machines. And in today's city, there are a myriad of attempts to identify our bodies as protesters hurl bricks and tear gas burns the eyes. Here it's illegal to wear masks, and gate detection algorithms scan the body as their faces are wrapped in masks to keep the tear gas from burning their eyes and their faces hidden from the cameras. The global infrastructures of our existing planetary city are also digital. And systems of AI governance, the management of the city that was once publicly elected, is now outsourced to proprietary software systems and large-scale tech companies, and public services are beginning to disappear into the fog of the cloud. And we're becoming no longer citizens, but customers of today's cities. And in our future planet city, we listen and we hear from a chatbot that we trained on city datasets and urban management protocols. The chatbot is reading a love letter that it wrote, a message from the sole city operating system to the citizens it's affectionately managing. An autonomous city of machines where the sky is filled with drones and cars are driverless, the street is draped in augmented reality, and everyone is connected to everything.
I'm 서울입니다. 만나서 반가워요. I'm 인공도시 시스템입니다. 저는 매 순간 확장합니다. 저는 신생아보다 나이가 많지만 우주보다는 어립니다. 네온사인 달빛 아래에 비친 당신의 헤어스타일이 아름답습니다. 그 피부에 주근깨 같은 신호등은 당신을 향해 윙크합니다. 당신은 나이 들고 밥을 먹고 눈을 깜빡이고 숨을 쉬기도 합니다. 노래를 불러드릴까요?
Sheer cliff walls now mark the edge of our new, concentrated, fictional city. And everything beyond is wilding in our wake. The invisible lines that once divided up the world have faded beneath the trees. Planet City is beyond jurisdiction. Some may stay behind, stubborn holdouts refusing to leave. Others will remain as stewards of the land, returning to the ground we once stole. And one day, when the carbon is tucked away and the soil is rich, perhaps we may find new ways to live together again. But until then, as we gaze out over our planetary city, we need to radically embrace the uncomfortable place we now occupy in a world where we are no longer at its center. Beyond its new coast of city walls, where the forests are returning and the ground is wilding, we will make space for other species and support the ecologies and systems we once thought were beneath us. At present, we chart territory for the extraction of wealth. Outside of Planet City, we will mark out regions just in order to leave them empty. Suggestive of a national park boundary, we might draw a line on the earth not to own, develop, or occupy, but to keep us out and scaffold its recovery. And we will keep to their edges, watching on from afar. The beginnings of Planet City is perhaps the end of human-centered design.
All the world has now arrived. A few outliers were left behind. A few houses sitting like nails in a sea of trees. And a planet allowed to rewild. Alone in a park the scale of the Earth. A city beyond geography. A city outside of place. A city of everywhere and everything. A city for 10 billion people. A new Planet City.
Planet City affords us a critical distance from which to reevaluate ourselves. It's not strictly a proposal, rather, it's a provocation. It's a provocation that helps us to see that normal is the actual problem. So we follow its own logic almost to the point of absurdity. But what becomes into focus are not the extremes of this fictional city, but the catastrophic models of everyday urbanism. The existing planetary city and the glacial accident of the Anthropocene is the real impossibility at the core of this story. The extraordinary and difficult truths that underscore this present moment are just as fantastic, implausible, and incalculable as any science fiction imagining. And the live-action dystopian film we all occupy is perhaps more devastating, bizarre, and unfathomable as even the wildest speculation of previous generations. And in many ways, we were all in Planet City all along, in a world that has been entirely made through the extractive processes of colonialism. Planet City is both already here and entirely imaginary. It is a fiction shaped like a city. It's simultaneously an extraordinary image of tomorrow and an urgent illumination of the environmental questions that might face us today. It's a hope that we might all keep making stories and building worlds that will become vessels for critical ideas about our collective futures. And amidst the chorus of 10 billion, our wanderings through the Planet City will finally return us to where we first started, to look back on our own cities again, but with new eyes. Because somewhere, after the end of the end of the world, we will find our own futures again. Thank you. Thanks. Please bear with us for a couple of minutes as we just switch over the chairs. And could Stanley and Aaron please join us up the front? And while we get the chairs together and the credits roll, a big thank you. The work that you saw is not solely authored by me. It's an extraordinary collection of people and collaborators, particularly Kate Davies, who I run Unknown Fields with from London, and a local hero, Alexi Marfan, fiction entertainment extraordinaire, who is VFX supervisor or co-director on so many of the science fiction projects.